morning, everyone. Good morning to you. If you're still coming in, we encourage you to come in and find a seat as we begin our worship with the Lord this morning. May I ask you all to stand in the house of the Lord this morning? His word in Psalm 99 says, "The Lord reigns. Let the peoples tremble. He is enthroned between the cherubim. Let the earth quake. The Lord is great in Zion. He is exalted above all the peoples. Let them praise your great and awe-inspiring name. He is holy." And I think the one line that captures me is, "Let the peoples tremble." And as we go into worship this morning, let's see who we're worshiping. With the eyes of our heart, let's see who we're worshiping this morning. The King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, who is good and who is able. Amen. Let's pray together. Father, as we come into your house this morning, because it is your house, Lord, we may pray that we may put aside everything, Lord, that is a hindrance to us this morning. That, Lord Jesus, with everything going on, may we bring a sacrifice of praise to you this morning, knowing that you are a good God, a good Father. Lord, let our eyes be turned upon you only in this time to hear what you have to say through your word, through prayer, and through the songs that we sing. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
I
That was the announcement. So I think there are sign-up sheets at the back. If they are designated to different areas of cleaning, some heavy lifting. If you're younger, a bit more sprightly. So there are sheets out that you can go and sign up on. Just want to welcome back Alex. Alex hasn't been for us for a long time, so welcome back. I know you've been traveling a lot. Good to see you. And all of you, we just welcome you in the house of the Lord this morning. And we're going to take up the offering now, so we invite the stewards to come forward.
Come and worship. persistent in your prayers for all believers everywhere. And last scripture, James 5:16, the earnest prayer of a righteous person has great power and produces wonderful results. Prayer produces wonderful results. If you are in Christ and Christ is in you, you are righteous. And therefore, God will honor and answer our prayers. Amen. So we're going to go to a time of prayer right now. There are some names we're going to mention here as part of our community and our family at Gap Church. And we're going to pray continually over them till we see the results. God has been good. We've had answered prayers. And He will continue to answer as we continue to pray. Amen. So we're going to come together in corporate prayer right now and speak to Jesus and let Him know what's on our hearts this morning. Amen. Can we do that together right now? We pray right now, Father God, for the names mentioned on our broadsheet, which are Baby Noor, Lord Jesus, Jolie, Keith Coleman, Veronica Porter, and Fiona that is with us this morning. There's a good sign, Lord Jesus, she's on the mend. Thank you, Lord, for preserving her, Lord. And you're going to do wonderful things in her body, and you're going to heal her totally in Jesus' name. Knit the bones, Lord Jesus, and the op that is being scheduled as well, that your hand will be upon her. Thank you, Lord Jesus, if we can just stand with these people right now. Lord, Tracy van Heerden, Lord, and every cancer sufferer, Lord, in our church and those around, in Jesus' name, that you will stretch out your healing hand and touch them in Jesus' mighty name. We pray, guys, we must continue to pray for those in the prayer bowl. In Jesus' name, continue to bring your requests and let them be known to the Lord as well. So we pray over those prayer requests in the prayer bowl as well, as we write out faithfully in the presence of Almighty God, that you'll come through supernaturally for your people in Jesus' name. And Father God, we are praying for the scheduled elections coming up next month. Father God, in Jesus' name, we speak life into this country. In the name of Jesus, we decree that we are finished and done with corruption in Jesus' name, and that you will raise up godly governance in this country and in our city as well, of the Nelson Mandela Bay area. In Jesus' name, Lord, let your spirit breathe upon this area, upon this government. I pray for peaceful elections, free and fair elections without intimidation and fear, that people would vote, Lord, properly in Jesus' name, and that you could bring forth a godly government that we can worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. We are blessed to be in this country, to have freedom of worship, but Lord, we want to see the revival fires burning across this nation without hindrance in Jesus' name, and we thank you for it, Lord, and we pray for the persecuted church, Lord, as we read that word. Pray for believers everywhere. There are those that are persecuted. They cannot gather like this morning, but they have to do it in secret and hide, and they are persecuted and tortured and murdered for your name's sake. We pray for them. We pray for our brothers and sisters, Lord, right now that are in bonds, that you will touch them, Lord. Let them feel the powerful presence of the Holy Spirit comforting them and reuniting them, Lord, in Jesus' name. We pray for all the war zones. There's so many now, Lord, around the world going right now. Lord, men and evil people are plotting murders and wars, but Lord, the innocent suffer. But in Jesus' name, that you'll protect these people, Lord. Cover them under the shadow of the Almighty. And we thank you, Lord, that you bring a peace to this the region of the Middle East especially, and those other countries that are ravaged by war. In Jesus' mighty name, we thank you that you're able, you're mighty and you're powerful to come through on behalf of your people. And right now, before I close, if anybody has a name or a situation mentioned, if you put somebody's name perhaps into the prayer bowl, mention it. I know God's seen it already, but let's just speak those names that you need the Lord to do a work in families or in lives right now. And just for a couple of seconds, mention those names before the Lord in the presence of the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. We just make mention of the names, Lord. We make mention of your people, Lord. The sufferings, the healings, Lord Jesus, the breakthroughs that need to be done. We know that you're able to do it, as you've heard these names being uttered in your holy house, Lord, in Jesus' name, that you'll come through supernaturally and that we will see the joy of the Lord in people's lives because of answered prayer. God bless you. Amen.
If you're able, please join us as we continue worship. You may stand if you can.
Lord, have just want to challenge each one of us. What is it that God is asking us to lay down? Let's just not make these about songs that we know and words that we sing. But what is he challenging us to surrender? Is it an attitude? Is it a behavior? Is it a worry or fear? What is he challenging you this morning? If we say, I surrender, what are we surrendering? Our complete lives to him. That's what he wants. Amen.
I've heard a thousand. Sing it out. Believe these next words.
You're a good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. And I
You are perfect. You are perfect in all of
perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us.
Jesus, we thank you so much that we can love you because you loved us first. And Lord, as we sit in your presence and just abide in you this morning through your word, Lord, speak to us, speak to our hearts. Open the eyes of our heart this morning, Jesus. We just want to hear you this morning. We want to hear you speak to us, Jesus. Even now, Lord, speak to us in the silence. In your name we pray. Amen.
Am I on? Here we go. I greet you in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Guides and pray, Heavenly Father, I ask for your blessing on this teaching this morning, and I ask that each one sitting here is touched by your message. Heavenly Father, we welcome you here with open arms. We welcome the Holy Spirit to be with us. And may we enjoy your presence because you bring so much joy in our hearts. In the wonderful name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, amen. I'm truly blessed this morning, as I am every Sunday and every day, because we have so much to be thankful for. We really do, and we often just look at the negative things and we concentrate on that and we forget what we actually have. And Leanne was speaking about the freedom, the freedom that we have to be able to worship, and that is such a wonderful, wonderful privilege. We often take so many things for granted. And we forget about all the blessings that you have bestowed on us. And I just want to say welcome to everybody sitting here this morning and those that are watching. And I know they are part of my family is sitting here and part of my family is in Australia and part in Pretoria. They also watching. And I actually said I'd give them a wink, so I'm going to give them a wink. I hope they saw that. It's just wonderful being here, and it's to me, it's an honor and a very humbling experience. Because we stand before an almighty God, but he knows us by our name. He knows our secrets. He knows our inner feelings. We can't hide anything from him. For those of you that don't know me, I'm Brian Letoe. I'm an elder here at Gap Church. And from time to time, I have taught from here in the past. But as I say, it's really humbling. But I enjoy it. And I hope I say the things that touch the right buttons in your lives. Because that's why I'm here. That's why we speak every and teach every Sunday. It's not just a ritual of being here, but it's to come and listen to what God is saying to you. Rory has over the last few weeks focused on events taking place during the Holy Week, which ended in the Christ that arose from the dead. And today I'm going to focus on the day of the resurrection, just after his body or the tomb was found without his body. And I would like to ask from the outset, when do you know that God is talking to you? And how do you respond to that? What choices are you making? And what are the consequences of those choices? Because each choice you make in this life has consequences. And this has prompted me to talk to you this morning about the walk that you and I are on, a walk that could lead us to nowhere, or a walk that will lead us to somewhere. And so the title of this is Walking with Jesus, because that is going somewhere. The question that you must ask yourself is, are you walking with Jesus? Or are you just walking? It's a walk that requires choices, perseverance, endurance, faith, belief, trust, and hope. So how do we make the right choices? How do we walk through the stresses of this life? How do we deal with the disappointments and the failures? How do we get closer to God? How do we remain obedient when faced with daily temptations and the forever presence of our human nature, which is in conflict with our spiritual nature? It's a constant challenge. It's not a once-off thing. It's every day we are fighting this conflict. And being a Christian is not easy. Being a believer is not easy. It's a tough challenge. I want to read from Scripture the disciples that, two disciples that walked to Emmaus after what had happened. And I read from 24, chapter 24, Luke 24, verses 13 to verses 35. And now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 11 kilometers from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them. But they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" And they stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you only a visitor to Jerusalem? Do not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but him they did not see. He said to them, 'How foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not Christ have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?' And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus acted as if he were going further. 'Stay with us, for it is nearly evening,' The day is almost over, so he went in to stay with them. After they had urged him strongly, stay with us. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, were not our hearts burning within us while we were talking with, while he was talking with us and opened the scriptures to us? They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11, those with them, assembled together and saying, it is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon. Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. This passage is one of the great stories of the Bible. Two unknown disciples walking to Emmaus. Emmaus was a small village, inconspicuous. Nobody really knew about it. In fact, the name of it was called People Despised or Obscure. It was a village of no significance. Their hopes, together with many other believers, had been dashed. They had placed all their hope and trust in Jesus Christ to be who he was, he said he was to be, the long-awaited Messiah, the Son of God. Yet now, following his crucifixion and death, these hopes had been crushed and ripped apart. Can you imagine the despair? Can you imagine the disappointment? The hope that they had. And now it had all gone. And now, you thought you had a tough week this week. Well, that week had started with Jesus riding into Jerusalem on the back of a donkey on Palm Sunday, with crowds of people welcoming, singing praise and yelling, Hosanna, Hosanna, to the King of David, to the Son of David. People believing that Jesus the Savior was about to overthrow the authority of the Romans and free Jerusalem from them. Knowing that they had been treated as second-grade citizens, as slaves, under the very brutal authority of the Romans. And yeah, the Messiah had come, and the Messiah was going to save them from this. The days of peace and prosperity are here, so they believed. But as the week unfolded, so the events became fast and furious. First, the confrontation with the religious leaders, the Pharisees, who hated Jesus, who conspired to get rid of him. Then the betrayal of Jesus by Judas, one of the 12 disciples, who was paid 30 silver pieces by the Pharisees. This was followed by the arrest of Jesus and quick, corrupt trials, finding Jesus guilty of blasphemy. He said, as it was, and I quote, if this temple is destroyed, it will be raised again in 3 days. And they were saying, this is blasphemy. It took us 46 years to build this temple, and yet this man is saying that he will raise it up in 3 days again. But he was obviously talking about himself. Jesus was then flogged, insulted, degraded, and forced to carry his cross to Calvary, where he was crucified. And you thought you had a tough week this week. But this was the Messiah, the hope of all believers. How could it all end like this? This wasn't meant to happen. And so, as all believers that day were in this confused state of mind, overwhelmed by the events that had just taken place, the two disciples were deep in conversation on their way to Emmaus, discussing the events and the confusion that it had created. Jesus then joins the two on their walk and partakes in the discussion. And however, they are prevented from recognizing. And in the Bible, there in Scripture, there are a number of Scripture passages where people are prevented from recognizing Jesus. And God does this for a reason, a specific reason. The events of the last week were the talk of the town. There were people from many nations. Remember, it was Passover, and many nations came to Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover. And so there were people from all over the world that were all over Europe or wherever were there. And yet this stranger did not appear to be aware of what had happened. And of course Jesus knew exactly what had happened. But he wanted to hear what the two were saying about it. And you know, it lets me relate to the fact that Jesus Christ knows exactly what's going on in your life. But he wants you to talk about it. He wants to hear what you are voicing, what you are saying, what's coming out of your heart. Many times we feel, for whatever reason, despondent, depressed, and frustrated. And our hopes are often dashed. Those in the world place, with worldly views, place their hope in fame, fortune, career success, relationships, all of which will ultimately fail and let you down. You might get temporary satisfaction and feeling of great success. But let me tell you, and Paul says so, that if you are focused on being a successful person, and I'm not saying everybody must be failures. Of course you can be successful, but what are your priorities? If your success is focused for this world, then you are a pitiful person. Because the focus is not on this world, it is on the world hereafter. A true hope in Jesus will not let you down. But a misplaced one will. Those who think Jesus is there to fulfill their every desire will be let down. Those that think that God will make all problems go away, or that we won't suffer in this life because we are Christians, will have their hopes shattered. This is not biblical hope, but rather wishful thinking. Being a Christian is tough. What are your priorities? Where is your focus? And if it is where it should be, it is going to be constantly attacked and in conflict with what Satan is trying to do in your life. Things will only get better when Jesus returns. But Christians also have hope for this life when they trust in the faithfulness of God to do what is right for his children according to his will and plans. We are all in the hands of God. We are all in his hands. And he has a purpose for us. The two disciples had biblical hope, but their timing was wrong. Jesus then entered the conversation and explained to them what they should have known from the Old Testament scriptures. Everything that happened is in scriptures. It is all there. All they had to do was read it and study it. And so beginning from Genesis and through all the scriptures, Jesus taught them about himself. We also see in the story that Jesus wants to be wanted. When they arrived at Emmaus, Jesus made as if he was going to carry on. And they were so enlightened by what he had told them, they urged him to come into the house because it was getting late as well. And so he came in. He was invited into the house. And in the house, they had supper and he broke bread. And so their eyes opened. And they recognized him. And as soon as they recognized him, he disappeared. And that's when they realized that this was Jesus, and they went off with great excitement and realized that he had been risen. Risen from death. He had overcome death. And so they rushed off and went back again to Jerusalem. There's no Uber taxi, so they actually had to walk 11 kilometers. If they had not done this, they would not have had their eyes open to see who he truly was. As Christians, we need our eyes opened. We sang a beautiful song just now. Open our eyes, Lord. Open our eyes. Paul in his letters prays that our eyes as Christians will be opened to who we are in Christ. He wants us to know the Lord better, and in doing so, we will know the hope that we have, the glorious inheritance, and the great power available to those who believe. And these things are worth seeking and seeing. And so when they finally recognized who the stranger was, and their eyes had been opened, they realized that burning sense that they had felt when they started to hear when Jesus was talking to them on the road, that burning eagerness within to find out more. It was Jesus speaking to them. And so they made a quick U-turn and went back. They wouldn't have known the Lord as the resurrected and living one if they had not asked him to come into their house. And many Christians still don't. We don't recognize. They have come to the cross and know that the Lord is the one crucified for them, for their sins. That is the truth. But it is not all. We need to press on and go further as the disciples on the road to Emmaus did, and see him as the risen, living God. Their eyes were opened with the breaking of bread. And the breaking of bread is a thing that we normally do in communion, when we have communion, yeah. But it is also communion and fellowship with God each day that we have when we read and pray, and ask the Lord to be with us. And through this, our eyes are opened. In concluding, how does Christ handle our sorrows? Well, more deftly than the best surgeon in the world, more carefully than the wisest teacher, and with greater forethought than any other leader. The empty tomb must have caused the disciples extreme pain and confusion. Can you imagine? When we think God has failed us, it's common to feel frustrated and confused, and in fact angry. But it's comforting to ponder with other believers that things that trouble us as the two disciples on the way to Emmaus had been doing, had been troubled and confused. And at times we ask questions, but at times we simply need to listen to what others are feeling and saying. When we endure loss, disappointment, or confusion, the body of Christ, the church, is our comfort. And I can only testify that my family has received great comfort through our home group, through the church, through people praying for us in our daughter's situation. And I've spoken to many people that come up here and ask for prayer, that there is so much comfort in knowing that others care for you, knowing that others are thinking of you, are praying for you. And we must never forget that. And when we pray, we are talking to God and asking Him. It's conversation with our Father, and our Father loves us so much that He sent His only Son to die for us. The presence of the Lord brings not only love and strength, but also profound reassurance that He is there for us and with us. What we must also realize is that Jesus meets us right where we are. There where we are. No special place. The disciples on the road to Emmaus, on this insignificant village where they were going to, were unknown. They weren't in a temple. They were just merely discussing things. And God met them there, and Jesus spoke to them. So the question is, do we, however, recognize that Jesus, when we walk, is walking beside us? Do we invite Him into our lives? Do we urge Him strongly to stay with us for communion? God is our foundation, our security. And He wants us to invite Him into our lives. Not to know Him, or not to know of Him, but to know Him. And those are two very different things. We can come here every Sunday. We could read our Bible every day and pray every day, because we know of Him. But do we know Him? Our security, therefore, in God is through our faith that on His throne He is and always will be in control. Our security is in our relationship with God through Jesus Christ. We must invite Him into our lives and make a personal commitment to Him. That can only be decided by you. Just to know about God is not enough. I think we've been saying it the last few months, that if you have not made a personal commitment, if you have not personally invited God into your heart, into your life, then I'm afraid the Lord is going to say one day, but I do not know you. I do not know you. It's harsh words, but that is the truth. That is the truth. You must know your Father and not know of Him. Make that personal commitment, and if you haven't done it, do it. After the sermon, we will give you an opportunity, those that would like to come forward. There will be people in front that will pray with you and pray for you. In the wonderful name of Jesus Christ, amen. I'd like to end off, however, with a display which comes out of Revelation 22, verses 12 to 15. Revelation is a very interesting book which reveals to us what is going to happen. And there is no part in the Bible, the entire Bible, which is not true. Otherwise, we could take this Bible and discard it. Everything that is said is the truth. I am the way, the life, and the truth. God doesn't make false prophecies, promises. What he says in this passage, behold, I am coming soon. My reward is with me, and I will give to everyone according to what he or she has done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Blessed are those who wash their robes, that they may have the right to the tree of life and may go through the gates into the city. Outside are the dogs, those who practice magic arts, the sexually immoral, the murderers, the idolaters, and everyone who loves and practices falsehood. If you honestly ask yourself, what road am I on my road or God's road? What is my destination? Am I making the right choices? And can you answer without any doubt? Can you answer this morning that you have already or that you are going to give your heart to the Lord Jesus Christ? Amen. I want us to end off by saying out aloud the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Let's determine to walk with Jesus this week. Amen. Even as we go out and have fellowship with one another. But let's stand now and let's declare this as we go out. This is a song that says, this I believe, and it's the creed for our Christian walk. So let's stand together.
I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the
believe in life eternal. I believe in the virgin birth. I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection, that Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit.
Oh, the depth and riches and wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable his judgments and his paths beyond tracing out. Who has known the mind of the Lord? Or who has been his counselor? Who has ever given to God that God should repay him? For from him and through him and for him all things. To him be the glory forever. Amen. Go in peace, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, and have some coffee.